just give five, three or four minutes that you give to think about myself. In fact, there was an earlier book called Race and Culture in Psychiatry, which was largely addressed to psychiatrists. And there was the that was in 1991. So that was in 1988 or 87. And just to put it into context, they Routledge to publish it, the publisher. I had not a difficulty getting anyone to publish it, but I had a friend who knew somebody there, as happens, you know, and you get it done. That's the way things were in those days. Now you can get this published really easy. Routledge only published it in hardback. And I kept pestering them, saying, I want you to paperback because people won't buy it. The hardback is much more expensive. And then one of the editors phoned me up and said, well, you know, one of the psychiatrists, very well-known psychiatrist, that said that this is Maoist, neo-Maoist. You know, they took an insult there because, you know, communism was an insult. Say that someone's calling you someone, say that someone's Maoist was actually a worse insult. And she said, what do you think? And I said, I don't know what does that mean, you know, I'll have to look it up. What is Maoism? Now, I've just heard of Mao, I don't really know much about Mao. And anyway, I looked it up and went back and said, no, I think if anything, this is spiritual and not sort of biological. That's the only thing I can see. I mean, if Mao was a spiritualist, then probably this is Maoist. But then they did publish it because other people spoke. And that was the way it was. So it was considered, several of my colleagues didn't speak to me for some time after that book came out. But others wrote very highly of it. And I remember Linda Tesk, who's now quite a well-known psychiatrist. She wrote a very good review in the British Journal of Psychiatry, saying every psychiatrist ought to read this because it's something that's not talked about. Anyway. Just to blow my own I come from Sri Lanka. I was born and brought up in Sri Lanka. My formative years was Sri Lanka. It's a very Buddhist country. I was from a very minority religious group. My parents were Methodists, Christian Methodists. So it was I was a minority there in the religious government. But Buddhism sort of pervasive, it was very pervasive. The culture I was brought up in Colombo, middle class culture in Colombo. And my father was Methodist, but you know, they were Buddhist priests, his best friends. And the Buddhists and others, Pentecostals, people like this. Anyway, it was a very mixed up, mixed community that I was brought up in. And I was sent to my England to study medicine. I was sick. I didn't have much say. I did medicine, went back to do psychiatry. I wanted to do psychiatry, I didn't want to do anything else. I didn't really like medicine very much, the sort of biological medicine. And I thought psychiatry would be different. And so, in a way, but I came back in 1960. For various reasons, including I met my future wife here, and she wasn't going to go to Sri Lanka, so I had to choose. And the other thing was that I was pretty fed up with the system there, just before the Civil War, because it was really difficult times. And I did psychiatry here, and as I did psychiatry, I wanted to do research. I wasn't, and my bit of research I did was, I was working in the East End of London, and there's a large Jewish population, and I was interested in the culture, differences in cultural practices, etc., and how it affect mental states. And it was about the depression among Jews, and comparing Jewish with the non-Jewish communities. so that got me interested in culture. And again, I think I stopped there when I say this. Now the anecdote is that as I was doing this, the usual work of doing research is you get a Jewish group, a non-Jewish group, depressed Jews, non-depressed Jews, depressed non-Jews, and then you compare the four groups in various parameters. That's a traditional way, and that's what I did. And so we controlled for residents, we controlled for social class, because they were all East Enders, born and brought up in a certain defined area of the East End. So we said we controlled for social, we controlled for background. But as I was talking to people, I found actually we hadn't controlled the background, because the Jews had a very different life. Because these in the 20s, 30s, 40s, I did this in the 60s, in the 60s. And I realized that actually they had a very different background to non-Jews. Why? Because of racism, because of the anti-Semitism of that time. The black shirts, I heard about that, the troubles there. So I realized very early that if you're studying culture, you have to study race. Race and culture go together. All my books in Lebanon has been about race and culture. You can't separate the two, because in our minds and also in life conditions, in this country anyway, most countries, race, the idea of race is very powerful, and racism distorts the cultural practices and the way when people see other people of culture. So when you say other cultures, we often mean other races. And when you say other races, we often sometimes mean other culture. The two are so mixed up together, you can't separate them. Anyway, so I did psychiatry here, and as I got on, I realized that, you know, I was much more interested in the cultural area. I did this research, and then I became a consultant I worked in the asylums, because that was the style of psychiatry that was in the asylums in Epsom, and then as things changed, I went into a district general hospital in Enfield. I was there for 22 years as a psychiatrist. And things changed. We saw the changeover from asylum to community based psychiatry. And I wasn't happy. I was practicing in an area where there were large minority population, Bangladeshis, as well as black African Caribbean people. And what struck me was that they were not getting it properly from me, from the service I was running. And particularly black African Caribbean people said, well, this is, when I got to know people, they said, but you know, this is nonsense, this psychiatry. Said it's racist. Right? That hit me quite hard, and there were some of us were hit hard. Said, but you know, you're racist, you know, how am I racist? When I looked at it, I realized that actually the perception was that this was a racist system. And we have to take that seriously. If people feel it's racist. And I must be racist. And so why was I racist? How was it that I was in this thing that we were doing, and what we were doing was not just perceived, but actually experienced as racist. And that's what got me into studying race and culture, and much more, not so much Jewish, black, the black experience, and particularly African Caribbean experience, and particularly in the hard end of psychiatry. So that's partly what I come from, where I come from. I wrote books because I read a lot, and most of what I learned actually was not during my training, it was after my training. It was what I taught myself, and through talking to people, talking to service users, you know, talking to patients. And also, I was on the Mental Health Act Commission for about 8 years. And when it was first started in the 80s, it was a very powerful commission that had very strong powers of going in and examining what was going on and talking to people directly, and then reporting on what we found. And the reports came out in the 80s on racism, mainly about racism. It wasn't so much about culture, about the way people were being discriminated against and various problems. And it wasn't clear what this was, how it was happening. Because really I couldn't see myself being racist, I suppose I was, but it was this institutional racism. This is where we were edging towards understanding what institutional racism is. Unwitting racism, you know, is defined sometimes. Or many people is unwitting. And we don't even know that we are being racist. And the sort of things that were coming up, this is really from my very first book, Race and Culture in Psychiatry, that was nearly banned at work. Since then, government reports had this sort of, in the 80s and 90s, government reports had this sort of thing to say, yes, race is an issue, culture is an issue. So it's a mixture of cultural difference and racism interacting in a way, particularly with black people, Asian people, Jewish people as well, to some extent, and much less so. The blacker you are, it seemed to be worse. And this was really, I remember one saying that, you know, it's schizophrenia, you know, the diagnosis of schizophrenia, 20, 30 times if you were black. It's less now. I think that was the sort of statistics that were coming out. Britain was the lead in that in the 80s. In Britain we had statistics. We were doing ethnic monitoring quite early. In the rest of Europe, no, they still don't. In France, it's illegal to do ethnic monitoring. It's actually illegal. You can't do ethnic surveys defining people by ethnicity. In Britain we came to terms with that. The discussions about that, you know, is it racist to do ethnic monitoring? But, you know, we decided it wasn't, because we were doing it in order to look at what was going on in society and to try and improve things, to change things. Anyway, but these are the sort of things. And it's still, this table still stands. Some things are less, but you know, about police action, probably it's a bit less. Being transferred to doctors is a big place. Not being referred for talking therapies, almost 100%. If you were black, you were not referred. If you were Asian, you might get referred. If you were white, of course, it was much more. It was sort of, in the hospital I was, we did the first ethnic monitoring in NG. It was very difficult, it was very difficult, we did that. And that's the sort of table we got. If you were black, the proportion of people who were black who were inpatients were high, as outpatients a bit less, as day patients a bit less, community care much less. Those who were referred for psychotherapy, there wasn't a single one out of 120 not one. There was one Cypriot, and this was done by psychologists. So I remember putting this to, so we decided that, we got permission, decided that the best way forward would be to circulate these statistics. We asked them, each professional group, head of each profession, to comment on this. It is very embarrassing, but to comment on it. And people came up with those sorts of comments, but it made people think. And then the psychologist said, you know, must be something. But it was that the psychiatrists weren't referring people. It think the psychologist talked much, actually.
Because it's a conference where you've got to do that thing.
These are the sort of things. And then this is John on the keeping, Frank Keating is going to talk to you later. I think one of the talks is this table from there, because my earlier table was with you guys. Sorry, I keep pressing the wrong button. Let's see, let me just put let's see, the first book. That shows, you know, when you, why is this discipline race? I think all disciplines are actually educational system. The institutional racism was first described by the Black Power movement, by way back in the 80s, during the Indian America, during the civil rights movement. And it said, well, it was about the educational system, that it was actually, that there was institution, that they were not the teachers who were racist, it's the whole way of teaching and the way of doing things in school and the way people were selected and not selected. This was institutionally racist. Made this statement, and that's the thing that got revived. We used to talk about institutional racism. I remember trying to teach on this, and don't know when it's just institutional racism. It's sort of some sort of academic jargon that doesn't make any sense. But it was, of course, after Stephen Lawrence inquiry, that it became okay to talk about it. It became a real thing, and that we have to grasp this. And why was it? If you look at this, you say, well, if the country developed at this time, it would be extremely racist. Education developed at the time. And it was a matter, and you need to look at history. This is where I got very interested in history, seeing where we come from. How is it that we succumbed to develop? What happened? It was essentially, going back there, it was a study of madness. Psychology had succumbed to develop in the 17th century, in the 18th century, 19th century, through a study of madness. And it was, people were, the asylum movement came up in the 17th century in Europe, usually in Poland and in Germany and France and later in Britain. And it was that large numbers of people were pushed into asylum for various reasons, including madness. But a lot of them were just poor and they were unwanted. It's what we call the excluded. The excluded ended up in asylum. And gradually doctors became in charge of this. I won't go into the details. Medically, it became a medical thing. And initially, asylums were actually looked after by the church, and in most of Europe. And then doctors became in charge. Doctors upon alienists in Europe. They were the people who were in charge of asylum. They were the people who decided who was alien to society, who should be put away, and who are okay to be in society, who should be put away. In Britain, they were called the mad doctors, more down to earth. They were always more down to earth. They were the mad doctors. The doctors were a bit funny anyway. They can look out to the mad people. They were the mad doctors. They were officially called the mad doctors. Mad doctors. They weren't real doctors. They were mad doctors. So the that sort of stigma of madness applied in the psychiatry, in the medicine too. They were the mad doctors. And so the you can see there. And as it developed, what were the sort of ideas about other people, the other? Was reflective in what was going on. See, some people say British history, European history, is in Asia and Africa and America, more than it's in Europe. It's what was going on, what Europeans were doing actually out there, and coming across these other people and making judgments about these other people. That's where the racism really became established. And race, in fact, the very idea of race became established maybe during the Atlantic slave trade and then the colonialism colonialism actually followed the Atlantic slave trade because the Atlantic slave trade gave the means for Europeans to have the Industrial Revolution that gave the power to go out and dominate the countries. So the Atlantic slave trade made the colonialism. This is history, and that's a book by this book came out actually, and it's been studied at the University College, came out very recently, and it's actually a study of how educational systems, how the legacy of race and the legacy of racism, the legacy of colonialism, how it affected everything. It affected the way history was written, geography was studied, it affected literature, it affected school books, community, public arts, students, family. And this came really partly, the University College, they had a course studying this, because if you ever get a chance, look at YouTube, look at I'm sure you look at YouTube, I think if you Google why is my curriculum white? It's very recently, about 3 or 4 years ago. The students at the University College developed this question, and they got a little, I think it was during one of the Black Month, Black History Month, that they developed this as a part of the Black History Month, about 3 or 4 years ago. And then a course developed around that. Why is my curriculum white? Why is everything I teach about white people? Why are my professors all white? And then another part of it was, why isn't my professor black? And there were various parts to this. Because in Britain, there's been a bit of a scandal in academia. A lot of black sociologists, people who get high up in who are black, emigrate, even in psychiatrists, the few black psychiatrists who have reached the top, he just could not get on. He was recognized, he could get the promotions, he went to heaven, people have destroyed, still happening. And, lots of stories about University College where this has been highlighted, but not actually much done about it. But this is institutional racism. This is actually not individuals. It is a sort of way the whole system works. And so that's how psychology, I think, became racist. But also it's about looking wider, the culture of psychiatry itself, when you look at the history and how it developed, find a way, the sort of it developed very much in Western Europe. It's based, psychiatry is about the mind, psychology is about the mind. The mind isn't like the liver, or even the brain actually. The mind is about the total person. It's about everything we think and live, our lived experience. And this is where a big difference in how, when we say Eastern cultures are holistic, or African cultures are holistic, That's what we mean, actually. That when in Sri Lanka, I remember, when I was here, and even still to some extent, but much less so, what is mental is conceived, is out there, is not in here as much as out there, it's here and out there. It's a total, mental is a total being. Then this is what we mean by saying it's holistic. And so the styles of the traditions that developed were very different in other cultures. What is always the West and the rest, they say. The West against the rest. That's how history is taught, it's the West and the rest. Everything is the West and the rest. So I keep to that to some extent, because that's the way we think, actually. We all think like this. And the diversity of traditions, the psychiatry and psychology developed in the West, and it reflected the concepts of how the West saw human beings, how that had developed. Developed out of the Middle Ages was very was a superstition, you might say, full of primitive thinking, you might say, and after the Enlightenment of the 17th, 18th centuries, the Enlightenment ideas, that's when psychiatry and psychology developed. The sort of ideas of the Enlightenment promoted these disciplines like psychiatry and psychology. As science then developed, particularly in the Arab, in the sort of Islamic part of Europe, I would say, the North of Africa. But that's jumping. But other psychologies, that psychology reflects the sort of the Western ways of thinking. But you know, I don't want to pursue this too far, because West, East, North, South, I mean, we are all interconnected. There isn't sharp differences. There's been connections between, say, East and West, going back to almost prehistory. The ways in which knowledge and was shared is during the connection between China and India. You know the three hairs? You don't know three hairs. Now in Devon, we go to the Dr. Devon, several churches in Devon have this three hairs symbol. It appears on various monuments and on various emblems. The three hairs, I've got a picture. But now the three hairs symbol, three hairs in a round thing with the ears. They only have, some of the ears I don't think of, and I can't explain it anymore. But that appears right along into China. It appears in, this has only been discovered the last 10 years. It's in Cairo, discovered in mosques, I think, in 3 years, in various places in North Africa, in Eastern Europe, in China, and on the other side of China. And it seems to be reflects the sort of connections that were there during the Middle Ages, even before the Middle Ages. And there are lots of things are there that indicate the connection. The Bamiyan Buddhas, you know, Taliban is Buddhist. They were Greek Buddhas. They had Greek faces. They were Greek Buddhas. And now they have uncovered certain connections very recently, last 4 or 5 years, of how is it that Greeks were in Afghanistan? There were Greek people, Greek cultures were currently trading sculptures in Afghanistan. This is BC. And historians have made these connections too. So it's, the connections are there all the time. So you know, these are not entirely separate. So they are different cultures together. People wanted to find out things about themselves, wanted to travel to Sakarji. People wanted to care for the sick, care for the man, care for people who couldn't cope. And so different systems developed, different ways of doing it, based on philosophies, cultural philosophies. And the other psychology, so there are various psychologies. There are various ways of studying the mind that develop in various situations. These are only a few. I'm trying to get a book with a colleague in Toronto, trying to get a book together, because there are lots written about this, that there are these different psychologies, but written in terms of religion and in books about religion. But in the West, psychology is sort of being separated from religion. That happened during the Enlightenment. Psychology developed as a, there was a great conflict between the sciences. Psychology developed as a science. Science and religion had a great conflict, the Catholic Church. The Catholic Church, the Inquisition, great conflict with the scientists. Galileo was, the story of Galileo. He was English, he was hurt by the Inquisition because he believed that the earth, essentially because he maintained that the earth was round and not flat. And the Inquisition, that's heresy. So it's a sort of political fight between scientists and part of what happened was that scientists said, well, we don't want anything to do with religion. Religion is nonsense. And spirituality was pushed out. This didn't happen outside Europe. This didn't happen in Asia, Africa, North America, the pre-Columbian civilization. It didn't happen. It only happened in Europe. So what developed in Europe, the psychology, was excluded spirituality. I think it was partly, it was a political fight. It was a political fight. Science won, of course. Religion being the Catholic Church. And it was the institutions that were fighting each other. And there were various psychiatries developed as well. There were other psychiatrists, for instance, in Tibet, the sort of psychiatry. Psychiatry, to divide psychiatry as a mixture of various, mixture of ethical. We make judgments about people. You know, if you have a belief that, that the world is flat, not round, and there are some bad people who think like that. We call it a delusion. It becomes a symptom of illness. If you believe that you're Jesus Christ, it becomes an hallucination. So you're silent in Jesus Christ. That's maybe the delusion of Jesus Christ. Yeah, but there's symptoms of it. We, our psychology, a way of thinking, has developed this sort of system of categorizing, if you like. And psychiatry is mixed up with all this. We believe ethics good. It's a good belief or a bad belief. I don't know whether you've seen, you probably haven't seen, you're not far from St. George's, the film made in 1995, very well known in some circles, in psychiatry in training. Not by psychiatrists, but like it, psychologists and social workers like it. Because it psychiatry comes out badly in there. It's a film, a documentary called Who's Whose mind is it anyway? You know, anyone saying that? Yeah. Whose mind is it anyway? I still show it sometimes and stimulate discussion. It's about that guy at St. George's, speaking. It is a documentary, who said that he was related to the, his big delusion, called it delusion, was that he was, he should be the Tsar. He was Romanov, and he was related to Romanovs because he was descended from the Romanov family. And I got very involved with that person because I did a second opinion. I said, well, he's not bad. There's no reason to put him on a section and give him medication. He's not disturbing anyone. I mean, he's, maybe he's related to Romanov, so what does it matter? But no, he was writing letters to the Queen because the Queen was his auntie. Well, Queens, he could write to me and say, well, I mean, I'm not interested, but I don't upset me too much. No, this was became very serious. And actually, he was the section, he was given heavy medication, it destroyed him. And, documentary is about the destruction of a person because he had a delusion that he was related to the Queen. Now, why was it so bad? He was bad. We related to the White Queen. Because I know white people who said this. It's got to become a delusion. This, well, to be cranky, eccentric. And during that that episode with that, I remember I spoke to various people. I went to the tribunal. At the tribunal, the social worker said, well, you know, he's dangerous. He keeps writing to the Queen. And the chairman of the tribunal said, oh, I don't worry about that. He said, you know, the Queen has a special department, people who write to her, to say that they're related to her. You don't know that. So the race, culture, the delusions, the views we have about people, judgments, all this gets mixed up. And so country is like this. It's sort of, it's a nonsense actually, when you have to think of it. But it is a reality because of the history. The way we had a very, the medical approach had a very powerful effect on the asylums, making them more humane, many areas. So it was important, the medical involvement of the silence was important in some ways, it was bad in other ways. But if you learn the history, if you go into history, see how it has come about, you begin to see that in other places, you know, it's different. And there are other psychologies, I'm trying to, as I say, get a book together, to bring, getting chapters on Maori psychology, Buddhist, Hindu, Islamic, Anishinaabe, that's sort of one of the North American indigenous psychologists, South African, etc. And we don't talk anything about this. Psychologists are not taught anything about this. And the training is not, it's poor. The training does not fit us to work in a multicultural society. And that is a very big problem. I think basically, if we can change the training, things would be much better for psychiatrists and psychologists. It's not their fault, it's not my fault. And it's it was too late by the time I came to understand this. So it's a whiteness of knowledge. We call it the whiteness of knowledge. The side disciplines and psychiatry and psychology, starting with the side. The knowledge is largely derived from ideas about madness, mental health problems, derived from Western European cultural sources, only based on Western ideas about human nature, the mind, and often they're Western ideas of the 18th, 19th century, not modern Western ideas. And we draw science of the 18th, 19th century, not on 21st century, And people have written again, scientists have written out the science of the physics, or modern physics. I don't understand much of what they call quantum physics, etc. Modern physics is much more like the Indian mystical ideas. The five ideas in modern physics is similar to the mysticism of the Indian culture. How about the Vatican culture as well? They compare it to the Indian culture. So that, you know, science has also moved on. And in a way, I think psychologists and artists are stuck in the 20th century. Again, the whiteness is emphasized by people who question this. Don't get jobs. I got jobs. I didn't question it until I got jobs. Actually, I was thinking, but I didn't try. I know when we were in the Transcultural Psychology Society in the 80s, we had big meetings. And I know one or two, there was a guy in the north who did a study on the use of ECT. And he showed that nearly all Asian women who complained of depression got ECT. All. Very few white women. He never got a job. He just could not get a job after that. So you have to be very careful. Now, this is where race comes in all the time. You have to work things to not be too upfront until you get into a position of power. Unfortunately, a lot of people who get to positions of power, that people, other people who upfront because they don't feel upfront, you know. So there's a sort of selectivity. People who provide things and other issues. Why is my critical writer? Why is that there? And I said the culture. The culture of psychiatry that is very much enough from European, you can say it's old European. I'll just show one of these slides. Wait to add the guy again. Now, before the psychiatry came up after the Enlightenment, before the Enlightenment was the Dark Ages in Europe. Was the guess superstition the 10th to the 15th century? Well, during that, there was a blossoming of culture in the Islamic world. In North Africa, the Arab. And there was a very different sort of psychiatry and psychology there. And there were the Meristans. Again, there's very little written about this. A few books, a lot of it is Arabic anyway, they essentially translated. But the Meristans were the mental hospitals. The big ones were in Cairo, Aleppo, this is a picture. About 20 years ago, come back and watch, you know what it's like now. It's probably going to say. The buildings are there. They changed, but in the 10th to the 13th century, while Europe was in the Dark Ages, there were mental hospitals treating mainly melancholia. It was drawn from Greek ideas of psychologists. And melancholia, schizophrenia is a new disease. Melancholia, depression is much older disease. And the therapy in the memory scans were described in these sort of ways. A sort of Foucault. Some writers in Europe too wrote about this. Foucault said there's a sort of spiritual, Foucault's very critical of psychiatry. And he said, well, just across the way, across from Southern Europe, was a very different sankharma being done in the many stands. But the spiritual therapy involving music, dance, theatrical spectacles, readings of marvelous stories. But also people were tied up. A lot of the doctors were rabbis because it was a mixture of it was healthy, but it was the medical people were rabbis because the Jews and the Muslims that's the only book I could find in English that has going to be in some detail, much management of the Islamic society. These were the sort of psychiatrists at the times, and all body mats of 10th century, before the 10th century. If you've been to Cordoba, have you been to Cordoba? I've been a couple of times. Really, my morning days was a rabbi, who was also the physician to the caliph. And he wrote a lot on melancholy. And he was really the first to describe that depression and mania are two sides of the same coin. We attribute that to Kraepelin, because Kraepelin in the early 20th century rediscovered. He also said depression and mania, but this was in the Maimonides, was in the 1100. Kraepelin was in the 1900. So that's about 800 years earlier. Maimonides had written the same thing he discovered this. And Dr. Witt was around depression in the medical. A lot of similarly, in the 10th, about the same time, 12th, 13th century, there's a sort of Tibetan type of support. Apparently in Tibetan medicine. Again, the only book is Eric Clifford's book that I recently, anthropologist who wrote on Tibetan Buddhist medicine. And it's sort of psychology. It's a sort of doctors who specialized in the mind. I'll just mention these two and stop, shall I? Because I don't want to get on. A lot of the transcultural so-called literature is, I think, no use actually, because a lot of the research has been done on Western terms. You start with illnesses like schizophrenia, which means nothing outside Western culture. You have to take the culture with it if you're going to make sense of it. So the schizophrenia, they try and recognize different illnesses in Asia, say, or in Africa, and then they compare. Now, it's, I'm looking to this, but this is what is called category fallacy. In transcultural psychiatry, this is a nonsensical way of doing research, because you're using an illness that has been defined in a particular culture, in a particular time, in a particular social and cultural framework, and using it to identify something in another culture. Doesn't make sense, because that doesn't make sense of being an illness. But in the WHO, did some studies in the 60s and 70s. Again, they look at schizophrenia. They try to find schizophrenia in 7 different continents. And they identify groups of people. And the idea was that we would see how culture, how in different countries, it works out differently. And they got a bit, the idea was to extend the Western treatments to university. And they got the whole thing fell down, because what they found was that in India, you identify schizophrenic people in India, follow them up, they do very much better than those who are identified in Washington or India, in Nottingham, or even in Russia. And similarly in the African centers, and the South American centers, and the Asian centers, had much better outcomes, where there was no treatment. as defined in the West. But there was treatment, you know, people were, there were other things being done. You know, that's another topic actually, what was being done. These are two recent things. One is that Tamil Nadu takes people who attended a healing center in Tamil Nadu, in India, and most of them, nearly all, could be defined as suffering schizophrenia. The outcomes were equal or better than in the local mental hospital. And this was in Kerala, a similar study looked at against psychiatrists, looked at people attending Hindu healing center, Muslim healing center, Christian healing centers. Kerala has a relatively large Christian population as well. I went to one of these places in Kerala, probably. But there, and there's also an Ayurvedic hospital for the mentally ill in Kerala. And there is the mental hospital. And when they looked at people, communities, who received treatment in any of these places, if you call those treatment. They're not identified as patients. You don't call them as patients, except for the Ayurvedic hospital and the mental hospital. But what they found was that people shop around. They try one, they try another, and on the whole, about a third benefited from each of the three. Some benefited most from the mental hospital, some from the Ayurvedic hospital, and some from a healing center, Christian, Hindu, Muslim. Didn't really make any difference. If you know the healing center, I went to a healing center in Vatican in East Sri Lanka when I was there in 2007-2012. I will talk about that trip anymore here, but that was a church, St. Jude's Church in Vatican. It's a healing center, and the Catholic Church. And I talked to the nun there, was sort of strong, and she said that the main healer, as it were, the pastor wasn't there, he was in the wrong, he was lecturing on healing. And he said people come, and they come, and they have a 10 minutes conversation with him, and they have something else, some other ritual. They all go to church and they worship. He said, are there many Christians? He said, oh, there are no Christians. He said, there are Muslims and Hindus and Buddhists. Christians go to another St. Jude's, actually, in a Christian country. But it's St. Jude's, there are several St. Jude's in Sri Lanka. And as far as I could make out, there are more Christian healing centers than actually Hindu or Muslim. In India, it's different. Now, we don't know what goes on in these healing centers. What is actually therapeutic? What's happening? What are the treatments? We haven't, these have not been looked at with a Western eye. We need to do that, actually. Because, you know, we are really one. We need to learn. We can actually, that may be why the outcomes were so much better in India than in Washington. It may be that they go to lots of other things. They shop around, they'll stop there. And there's a, I did a short article, one of the Mind, the journal that Mind used to run, called Becking User Choice, and I sort of extracted from that last the lessons to learn from that, the Kerala study, is that the best thing is to have various types of treatments, various things open to people under the health service. But in India, you have to afford to do it, otherwise, you can't choose. You can't choose anything. You may just be knocked out somewhere. If you can choose, you find it. Seems to be very effective. And if we have that, user choice, people can then shop around, find us less. and that's how the best results will be. And you can have these.
Thank you. Can we just thank Professor Rand? Moments for some question and answers.
He can control much of your time.
No, it's interesting that you finish on the topic of shopping around. Because those of us who work at the Community Empowerment Network know that we are working towards establishing family therapy clinics. We call them clinics, but family therapy places within churches, within mosques, here at Mushkil Hasan, at New Testament Assembly Church, and so on and so forth. Because the idea is that if we can train people to provide healing and therapies in a variety of places, then people will be able to shop around. They don't just have to go to Springfield Hospital, they can go to the mosque, they can come here, they can go to the church. So I'm pleased that you finished on that point. But I think it was a real tour de force, particularly on a kind of historical understanding of how psychiatry and psychology came about when I was speaking to Professor Suman previously, and the kind of connections between the development of imperialism and racism and the correlation between that and the development of psychiatry, I think is a very useful kind of understanding about how it developed.